Change is happening all the time. We know that that's inevitable. But when we adapt to change, we survive. When we create the change, we thrive. And when we resist the change, oh, this is going very fast here. When we resist the change, I feel we become obsolete. Now, we all have in us imagination. We all have in us dream. And in all our different skills and craft, whatever we are doing, we all have the potential to create the change. So let's be proactive and try to make a change rather than just be a reaction to it. That's the idea I want to share here today. My craft is cinema, and cinema is about 125 years old. Yeah, it all started with this machine called the kinetoscope, you know, which was actually the first time people saw moving pictures. It was a series of stills like those flip books that we used to play with as kids. And it really intrigued people because they would look one by one into this box and find some picture moving, a horse riding or something. And I think that was the beginning of cinema. A few years later, the Lumiere brothers showed a silent film in Paris, first paid for audience in a theater. And it even scared some people. It was silent, but they had a running commentary and music and stuff. And people ran out of the theater. Many people thought they were ghosts. Then the first talkie came, the jazz singer, as you can see. And from then on, it's been endless. You know, we know where it is today. There was widescreen, there was 70mm, tadao. So many things happened in cinema. Now also smaller screens came, screenlessness came, virtual reality. And now there are a million tools to play with, a million things you can do in this craft to tell stories. And everywhere there was a dreamer. Somebody who had imagination, or dreamers who had dreams, and they invented stuff and gave us all these wonderful tools to play with. When I started, I was making films for cinema. There was no TV then, there was no video, nothing was invented yet, at least not in India. And it was a tedious process, in the sense it was not an accessible process. It was expensive, and you had to be a bit privileged to learn how to make films. I was from a film family, so I was surrounded by technicians. And you know, you had to take stuff to a lab, use expensive cameras, wait for the rushes, cut the film, splice it together with glue and stuff, like you said. And there were so many processes involved. Today, of course, any child can make a film because, you know, you have a phone, you have a computer, you have some imagination, you can make a film. That's wonderful. But that time, it was not so accessible. But I tried to learn what I could, you know, from books and stuff. And I sort of proclaimed myself a filmmaker at 17, self-taught, without any experience. And luckily, the first job I got was for a commercial which somebody trusted me with. Now, I was all of 17. Here it is.
Come alive with little freshness, with the exciting freshness of limes. Lyril, the freshness soap, to make a fresh new woman of you.
So this was is a flash of what we did then. Thank you. This was mid-70s, and I mean, it's amazing that some of you still remember it. It was only for cinema then. I've just shown a flash of it. And the brief to me was, it's freshness of limes, and, you know, make that come across. They showed me a beautiful wrapper with ripples. They showed me a soap with ripples. And no real script. This is just a girl playing with water. In fact, the auditions they showed me were of various perspective models who were dead shot playing with waves. I thought waves are not very fresh because they're salt water, you know, in the sea. So I went all around the country. I looked for a waterfall. Then while I was searching for a waterfall, I was trying to look for new angles to get into it, under it, behind it, with a Super 8 camera. There was no video then. So that also had to be processed and stuff like that. And I was also trying out choreography in the water. I was alone, putting the camera on a rock and trying it out to see what new things a girl can do in the water. I think this commercial made a lot of change. Two changes I can think of is, yeah, I was also thinking of the editing. You know, I had read about something called subliminal images, which was actually flashing two or three frames at a time at an audience. In some countries, it's banned because it's supposed to either give you a headache or disturb you, but they were doing it for advertising. This I used more obviously on drum beats. So that editing style became, it was new in India, it was revolutionary. It was then later on used a lot. And the style of the choreography, all these things came out even, I saw subsequently in Bollywood films. They would use it for song picturizations and even in the South. And that way it did set a trend technically. But I think more important than that, you know, this girl, we designed it not to be overtly sensuous or sexy. We designed it to be like a, you know, like more having fun. It was all about freshness. So when we did that, I think some shackles were broken. The housewife those days, typically in an ad, had to wear a mangalsutra, had to have a bun, had to have a sari, and had to be, you know, a prototype. And it was very, very typical in all housewife commercials for soaps, for detergents, for everything. This was a bit of a breakthrough. Now she had the liberty to enjoy her bath in her privacy and not feel ashamed. You know, you could see this ad with your family and everything. So I think in that sense, we did do a breakthrough work in advertising, and till you see till today, the whole profile of the housewife has changed completely. You know, now there are housewives who are, you know, working while the husband is doing the washing. There's so many commercials like that, which is beautiful. Okay, so then after that, I did another commercial. I'll just talk about a few commercials. I feel that I did make changes. This is another flash.
Vitalia glucose day. Now gaar bachcha janta ke gabbar ke asli pasand kya hai. Asli cheez samjhe.
Okay, couple of things happened with this ad. First of all, it was very brave of the client to buy this idea, because gabbar at that point, everyone's seen Chole, I'm sure. Even the kids may have seen Chole. He was the scariest villain of his time. He was chopping hands and doing all kinds of horrible things to people. And because we used him to sell, in a funny way, biscuits to children, that any typical client, as you know, would have just said, you know, forget it. You can't use this guy, use the hero, use Amitabh Bachchan. But, you know, they bought him, and we went and made this. He was also enjoying it thoroughly, so he put a little bit more humor into it. And the other change it made, it brought that whole trend of humor in. I think it was brave enough for them to do, and then that trend started. But what I think more importantly was that Amjad himself was embarrassed to do an ad. And it was the mindset of movie stars those days. It was beneath their dignity a bit to do ads. They were saying, "Kya tel sabun ki picture bana rahe hai." I know they won't do it. But, and they never wanted to admit that they're doing it for the money. And look at the endorsement scene today. You know, and in those days, Amjad told me, he said, you know, don't let anyone know that I've done this for the money. Just say that you gave it to charity on my behalf. You know, and but then, you know, people enjoyed this ad. It was quite viral. I mean, it was enjoyed in cinemas. I've just shown you a clip of it. And it went on. There were many developments after that in the industry in India. Video was invented, TV came in. Of course, till now, the non-linear editing, digital, so many things happened in the industry. And we were keeping up with it, innovating, doing special effects. Like you said, you're not trying to do something with computer animation, trying to do something. Yeah, sometimes you made a breakthrough, sometimes you were noticed, not always. But it was always very fulfilling to know that you've done something good, something new. You've used your imagination, you've used your dreams, and made a reality, made a change. And I think that's what I strive to do right through and enjoy it always, whether it's technically or in storytelling. Then came another major change. This was beautiful teamwork. There was a set of national integration films where I teamed up with ONM. Piyush was there at that time. And the very, very legendary creative director, Suresh Malik. And we did a set from the 85 onwards of 4 or 5 films, which, you know, over every year, which I think really changed a lot of mindsets and changed a lot of things. What happened in that time was the first film, it started with a sports film. It was called The Torch of Freedom. I'll try to first show you a flash of all the films combined, because the films are too long to see all together. Have a look at that and then we'll talk about it.
Mile sur mera tumhara to sur bane hamara.
सुर्खी नदियां पर दिशा से बह के सागर में मिले बादलों का रूप लेकर बरसे हल्के हल्के
Yeah, so this the first film was The Torch of Freedom. Suresh and me went up to Delhi to meet Rajiv Gandhi, who was then Prime Minister of the country. And he gave us a very interesting brief. He told Suresh and me, he said, today young Indians are not very proud to be Indians. I think that was because there were the days before globalization and things were pretty closed up in India. We were still third world. We weren't even recognized as a growing economy or, as an upcoming economy. And he said, do something to make them proud. So Suresh and me, I remember we came back with this brief, had a few drinks, sat together. We both knew that we loved sports. And Suresh was a genius. He used to love, he knew the name of hockey champions, he knew the name of football coaches from way back. And we said, why don't we do this? This was much before mobile phones and email. So we wrote letters, beautifully composed letters, and managed over 3 months to put together so many champions and sportsmen. Some we knew personally, some were in different parts of the country, and we thought we'll do this with this most amazing country as a backdrop. So many beautiful places. There was actually that sense of pride that we had, and we wanted to share that, and I think that came through. The sense of pride in the country, and what better way than to have sports icons, sports like we've seen unifies everybody. There was quite a few cricketers in that. And then this amazing track happened. The track really was a combination of our national anthem and inspired by Chariots of Fire that time, because that was a sports film which was actually trending. Louis Banks had done the track. And although we couldn't use this national anthem in a half manner, in an aborted manner, I think Prime Minister agreed, so it went on the air. The result of this was completely overwhelming. People were telling, and there was a television that just started, so it was being hammered on TV, on Doordarshan, the only channel, so everyone got a lot of chance to see it. And it just, don't forget, those were the days of Films Division documentaries, which were being forced upon people in every theater. They weren't bad, they were interesting, they were well-made, they were informative, but rarely emotional. So what happened here was there was an emotional appeal. And I think that feedback came to us from all corners. And of course, we went back to do Mile Sur Mera Tumhara the next year. The next brief was do something like this again. Piyush here did the wonderful lyrics. And we put together a team. We decided this time we'll use some movie stars, we'll use some real people, again, all over the country, all the languages, and some great singers. We gave those lyrics to Bhimsen Joshi ji, and he came back to us, 2 weeks later with this wonderful tune. I remember he recorded for about 45 minutes, and we cut it down to about 30 seconds. He was just improvising. He left him to in that recording just with the tape on. So anyway, that happened, and then Melesu's magic and other stuff. Eventually, I did it again for Times of India just a few years ago, because I wanted the anthem to live on. Like you said, tradition, the soul should remain. So we brought in all the contemporary stars into it. A lot of people didn't recognize Bhimsen Joshi today. And then, so we went on to the next thing, which is Phir Mile Sur. That time it wasn't shown much on TV, but very viral on internet, which is the new medium. In fact, if you look at the future of what's happening in storytelling, now the sky is wide open. There's virtual realities, there are holograms, all kinds of things are happening. If you look at the new toys we have to play with, and everything is coexisting, I think, simultaneously. There's widescreen, there are big theaters, there are theaters you can go to and spend $1,000 ahead, which is a lot for India, and have dinner and recline. At the same time, you can watch a movie in the train, on the go, on your phone. So I think all this is going to coexist for sure, and it gives you more and more tools for storytelling. I wouldn't be surprised if tomorrow there's a superstar who's actually a robot, a real robot, or a computer generated. Or you can wire a director's brains and make him project images or a story. Anything is possible. But the point is that new ideas, your imagination, and your dreams, if they are disruptive, disruptive is the new catchword, actually, which is often funded. If you look at the kind of disruptive ideas that have happened in the past, Wright brothers, the plane, and all that stuff, it's always been the new inventions come out of disruptive ideas. We all have these ideas, and we all have them in our own craft and skills. So again, coming back to what I'm saying is that we might be insignificant, in the context of the entire universe. We know that the universe is expanding, changing, stars are colliding, black holes are forming. We also know that our body is regenerating every 7 to 8 years completely. So changes are constant, it's happening in that sense. It's the nature of the universe. So it's almost like there must be some intelligence or some dreamer who's dreaming up a new form for the universe. And though we are insignificant in our own, in time and space, what I feel is that our little dream is part of the big plan, part of the big dream. So we should never feel that. We should try to make the change that we want. And even if you don't go down in history for it, it's going to be fulfilling. So just be proactive and make the change. Thank you.